Do you have the boldness to stand in front of whatever enemy you are facing and whatever enemy you may face this year? Whether the enemy is the devil himself, whether it's sin, whether it's debt, whether it's financial debt, whether it's illness, whatever you are facing, whatever you will face, stand up to it. Stand up against it. There comes a time when you have to have some aggression, some tenacity, and some might about you. And you have to stand up and fight back, no matter what is happening to you, no matter how hard the fight is. As long as you keep fighting, you will win. The devil only wins if you let him. Life will only win if you let it. Fight on, fight on, fight on. Don't tell me you can't fight anymore. Don't tell me you can't fight anymore. Don't tell me I'm tired and alone. After all you have been through, you've got to take a stand. You've got to take a stand. Stand in the middle of heartache. Stand in the middle of calamity. Stand in the middle of the storm. Stand in the middle of chaos. Stand in the middle of failure. Stand firm in the name of Jesus Christ. Whatever it is, it will not defeat you. If it is an illness, fight back against it. It will not win. It will not win. The devil and his army cannot stop what God has ordained for you in 2020. You will experience the blessings of the Lord this year. The crown of favor is upon your head. God will open doors for you. But your duty, your responsibility is to be bold like a lion. Look at the ones who have gone before you. Moses, described in the Bible as the meekest man ever. Yet Moses had the boldness to go face to face with the most powerful man on earth at that time and told him, "Let my people go." Boldness. The great soldier Joshua, who took the sword and led the children of Israel to conquer kingdom after kingdom after kingdom after kingdom. Boldness. King David, who slayed a lion, a bear, and a giant as a small boy. Boldness. You can't be bold if you see yourself as a victim. You can't be bold if you see yourself as a loser. You can't be bold if you see yourself as a coward. This is the year you realize you have the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob on your side. And he has equipped you, and he has fashioned you, and shaped you to be more than a conqueror. This is the year for you to walk in boldness. God's angels will protect you. His angels will minister to you. They will walk with you. The Holy Spirit will dwell inside you and will guide you. Victory will follow you. The crown of favor is upon your head. God has favored you. God has invested the blood of Jesus in you. You have royal blood running through your veins. This year is the year for you to finally take a stand in the name of Jesus. You are a child of God. Don't you dare let the devil dictate another year of your life.
Our God is strategic. Our God is a methodical God. Everything he does is calculated. Nothing just happens. God is in complete control at all times. He knows the past, present, and future. Nothing catches him off guard. He is perfect in his planning. He is perfect in his timing. His ways are different from our ways. He has the capacity to create visible things from the invisible. That is the power to create something out of nothing, to create life where there is no life, with only his words. He can never be stranded or caught unaware. Even when he chooses to be silent over a matter, he has a plan to achieve, a plan to succeed. There are no mountains before God. They all become plains in his presence. He is the one who laid the foundations of the earth. Is there anything he cannot do? God is mighty in all battles. He does not have to fight before he wins. He is always the victor and never the loser. He will always come out on top. No strategy, no ambush, no surprise attack will ever win against him. He knows all things, therefore he can win against all things. There is none more powerful than him. What an advantage, what a blessing that we have him leading our battles, the one who cannot lose. There are a number of things that can represent battle in the life of a man. Anything that afflicts, oppresses, discomforts, or maneuvers a man against his will or wish and cause him to be under perpetual pain and limitation can be likened to a battle. A battle is whatever a man struggles to take out of his life because it may be beyond his own power and ability. The battles that individuals are facing differ with varying degrees of intensity. Some people face the battle of sickness, barrenness, failure, delay, poverty, and the likes, while others are faced with more fierce spiritual battles beyond human understanding or explanation. The battle is of the Lord. And he said, "Hearken ye, all Judah, and all inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou King Josaphat, thus saith the Lord unto you, be not afraid, nor dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's." 2 Chronicles 20:15. Although both believers and unbelievers are faced with different kinds of battles, however, for the believers, conflicts are stories that lead to victories. Tests are the mothers of testimonies. Trials can only end in triumphs, and problems are won with solutions. Why? Because they have God taking up their battles. They do not rely on their own power and strength, but the children of God rely on the power and strength of God. In 2 Chronicles 20, about three nations had risen against Judah with the intention of utterly defeating them in battle. King Josaphat knew what to do by seeking the face of God. God's response to them was that of courage. The battle is not yours, but God's. In verse 17, they were told, "You will not need to fight in this battle. Position yourselves. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord who is with you, O Judah and Jerusalem. Do not fear or be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, for the Lord is with you." As children of God, we should never be afraid. We should never be dismayed, because the Lord is with us. Our salvation is found in God. He will help us fight the battle. God simply ordered some of the people of Judah to go into battle with singing and playing of music. They said, "Praise the Lord, for his mercy endures forever," whilst the others waited to attack. What a strategic God. The hotter the battle, the lesser the effort of God in winning it. They were able to triumph over the army to win the battle.
When God is with you, you don't have to live a life tormented by fear. We need to remind ourselves of the other name Jesus was given by his heavenly Father, the name Emmanuel. Because the name Emmanuel means God with us. We as children of God can live with the security of knowing that we are not alone. Jesus in John 14:27 states, "My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid. God is with you. Fear not," because of Isaiah 41:10, where God states, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." No matter what you are facing, fear not. God does not abandon his people. God does not abandon his people. Even before the coming of his son, he was near his people. and he is still near all of us in everything that we face. In every storm we face, God is with us. In every grief we bear, God is with us. In every sorrow we face, God is with us. Who is bigger, your fears or God? There is no need for us to be fearful, regardless of what we are facing in this world. Do you have the boldness to stand in front of whatever enemy you are facing and whatever enemy you may face this year? Whether the enemy is the devil himself, whether it's sin, whether it's debt, whether it's financial debt, whether it's illness, whatever you are facing, whatever you will face, stand up to it. Stand up against it. There comes a time when you have to have some aggression, some tenacity, and some might about you. And you have to stand up and fight back, no matter what is happening to you, no matter how hard the fight is. As long as you keep fighting, you will win. The devil only wins if you let him. Life will only win if you let it. Fight on, fight on, fight on. Don't tell me you can't fight anymore. Don't tell me you can't fight anymore. Don't tell me I'm tired and alone. After all you have been through, you've got to take a stand. You've got to take a stand. Stand in the middle of heartache. Stand in the middle of calamity. Stand in the middle of the storm. Stand in the middle of chaos. Stand in the middle of failure. Stand firm in the name of Jesus Christ. Whatever it is, it will not defeat you. It will not win. It will not win.
Make sure you subscribe to the New Lion of Judah prayer channel. Click the link in the description. James 5:13. Is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being, even as we are. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crops. Many revere the prophet Elijah as the preeminently the elder of the prophets. He stands as one who has done some of the most awe-striking feats of faith in the scriptures. To pray like Elijah and to have results like Elijah is the crying need of the times. Edward M. Bounds. He is nicknamed the praying prophet, and James seems to find in this arch prophet the perfect example for the Christian discipline of prayer. When we look at the exploits Elijah performed through his prayers, we must truly seek to have this much confidence in God. Even the evangelist Luke testified. After the brook had dried up, Elijah, under divine direction, crossed over to Zarephath, or Zarepta of the Sidonites. There he was hospitably received by a poor widow whom the famine had reduced to her last meal. Her charity he rewarded by increasing her store of meal and oil, all the while the drought and famine prevailed. Luke 4:26. In 1 Kings 17:17-24, we read, "Then he stretched himself out on the boy 3 times and cried to the Lord, 'O Lord my God, let this boy's life return to him.' The Lord heard Elijah's cry, and the boy's life returned to him, and he lived." These miracles alone are excellent testaments of the fervency of Elijah's faith. We should endeavor to have such faith in God to be as daring as the prophet. God's miraculous work in answer to Elijah's prayers also came when Elijah took his cloak, rolled it up, and struck the water with it. The water divided to the right and to the left, and the two of them crossed over on dry ground. 2 Kings 2:8. These may seem as if they are some sort of superhuman-like manifestations, the kind of thing some would ascribe to demigods. But James reminded us Elijah was a human being even as we are. Too often in church, when we hear, "Let us pray," it is ritualistic and doesn't evoke any consideration to engage the power of the omnipotent God. They are simply good Christian rhetoric. But let us consider that the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. We must not slight the effect that prayer can have on our situations. When we approach God to converse, we must always know that He is a willing Father who wants to move in His children's favor. When we pray, we are tapping into the supernatural and agreeing with the will and plan of God concerning us and the earth. There must be this conscious reality awoken within us that prayer becomes powerful when God's ears are tuned to them. And God is always leaning down to hear even the faintest whispers that resonate in the hearts of His beloved. As we pray, we must think of the imagery painted by these episodes in the life of the praying prophet. In 1 Kings 18 and 2 Kings 1, we have accounts of Elijah opening the heavens. He prayed and saw the heavens open in 1 Kings 18, 37 through 38. "Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that Thou art the Lord God, and that Thou hast turned their heart back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stones and the dust and licked up the water that was in the trench." In other instances, Elijah was able to cause the rain to fall, and in 2 Kings 1, he opened the heavens again, and the fire of God fell on God's enemies. At the core of Elijah's prayers was the desire to see hearts turn to God. When God answers our prayers, these are great testimonies of God's power. The world will look on and see that the claims we make about our Heavenly Father are true. So let us not take slight, feeble, and flimsy prayers to God. He declares in the Word, "Is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray." James 5:13, "Everyone faces adversity, but the saints have the privilege to call on God in the midst of our adversities." When we are delivered, the world will see the measure of our King's loving kindness towards us. Are you in trouble? Are you perturbed, burdened, seeking beneath a load of bills, emotional turmoil, or any other form of trial? Is any among you afflicted by sickness, bereavement, disappointment, persecutions, loss of health, or property? The word used here refers to suffering evil of any kind. Barnes notes on the Bible, "If you find yourself in this situation, then you must turn to prayer. We do not know any other recourse more fruitful than prayer. The most appropriate combat we can find is prayer." Hear the refrain from Montgomery's hymn. "Prayer is the burden of a sigh, the falling of a tear, the upward glancing of an eye, when none but God is near." Sometimes we are so burdened that we cannot enter into the long and lengthy petitions. But as Augustine pointed out, arrows of the Lord's deliverance shot out with a sudden quickness. These are ever in the power of the beleaguered Christian. And more things are wrought by prayer than this world dreams of. Saints, when we pray, We invite the power of God into our situations. It doesn't matter what we are going through and how dire they may seem. Let us pray. It's not a religious retort that ends in the mouths of our preachers. It is as Paul declares us, coming with weapons of righteousness in the right hand and in the left. James was convinced that God's power is to be found in the arena of prayer. He again asked another rhetorical question, "Is anyone among you sick? If there is such a one, James' advice is to let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord." He is advising us to have the posture in our hearts that will bring the omnipotent God into our most dire situations. When we do, James assures us the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. Notwithstanding, the sovereignty of God takes precedence. We must pray His will into our situations. So consider the truths we have gleaned from our discourse. God intends that we invite Him into our situations so that His power will work in our favor, and others who have not yet tasted His goodness will see Him working for us. The exploits of Elijah don't rest in his power, but in the power of the God to whom he prayed. Elijah was a mere man, but he trusted in the Almighty God. And when we do the same, our prayers yield power and become effective. So, my friend, are you in trouble? Pray to God. Are you sick? Pray to God. He rescues the troubled and afflicted, and He heals the sick.
Fear is a powerful emotion. It can push a person into wrong actions or even freeze them into inactions. Fear is a tool the devil uses against us to make us miserable and destroy our lives. It begins as a thought and then creates emotions that can rule us. It often becomes a strong and intense feeling as time goes on. You never want to make fun of someone who is afraid. It's very important to understand what fear is and how it works against us, because if we don't, it can keep us from becoming what God created us to be, which means we won't fulfill our purpose in life. This is not in the Bible, but it is my opinion. I believe that the spirit of fear is a master spirit the enemy uses to manipulate people and keep them out of God's will. Simply put, fear is the opposite of faith. God wants us to walk by faith, and Satan wants us to walk by fear. When we learn to live by faith and not let fear rule our lives, we can live a fulfilling, satisfying, peaceful, and joyful life in Christ. Fear can have a powerful effect on our thinking and decision-making, but as Christians, we have been given the power to overcome it. Therefore, we must not entertain it. Everyone experiences fear in their lives. We are very aware of great fears, and some little ones we may not even realize we have. Many of the things we fear never happen to us. And even when they do, all our anxieties and worries generally have done nothing to protect us. Absolutely nothing. The Bible does not minimize or trivialize many of the things we fear. In fact, it reveals to us that the world will become more dangerous and frightening as the end of the age approaches. But we have an assurance: His help. See what the Bible reveals to us. Isaiah 41:13. "For I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, Fear not, I will help thee." We must know that fear is the number one weapon of the enemy, and we must recognize diverse ways to defend ourselves against it. The Bible warns that fear can cripple our faith and thwart our Christian growth. We must know that a sound mind is essential in living the Christian life. Right thinking leads to correct living. Right thinking leads to what? Correct living. Having a sound mind is very important because we move, make decisions, and act according to the perception and comprehension of the mind. Just like the Bible says, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. It also says in 2 Timothy 1:7 that God hasn't given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Besides, God has called us to be faithful, not fearful. Unfaithfulness is the mother of fearfulness. Generally, sinners would run when no one pursues, but the righteous is always as bold as a lion. Fear is a spirit and must be dealt with accordingly, that is, it must be confronted with the breastplate of righteousness. The first step to confront fear is to remember who and whose sons and daughters we are. We have been given the Holy Spirit. This means that we are not alone, not even in the face of death. We need to remind ourselves of this fact frequently. If possible, confess words from the scriptures when faced with fearful situations. Do you remember what the Bible says in Isaiah 41:10? Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. What a promise! What a wonderful God! And to know that through Him we can have assurance and peace during those times of uncertainty. To know that even as we live in this year of uncertainty, He is our strength. He is our help. He will uphold. He is our God. And no matter what the year may throw at us, our God is with us. This is a good message to pick up today and whenever fear comes knocking. The presence of the all-powerful God. And then, from Psalm 91, God explained to us how to be free from fear. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall not be afraid. And from Psalm 91, we learned about that secret place that leads to the securest place. Thank God for the security we have in Christ. Hallelujah. Also, we need to understand that God is in control of everything. He is powerful, therefore there's no cause to fear. He's faithful and just to deliver us from all fearful situations. In fact, just as I've earlier mentioned in 2 Timothy 1:7, He has made available for us all that we need to conquer fear, power, love, and a sound mind. Let's subsequently expatiate that He has given us power. This is made more evident in Acts 1:8, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. Do you have the Holy Spirit within you? If so, then quit feeling sorry for yourself. Quit walking around with your head down. Quit allowing the devil to throw seeds of doubt and fear in your mind. You have the Holy Spirit inside of you. The Spirit of God. The Spirit of power. What can defeat the Spirit's power? Nothing. So stop living a fearful, cowardly life. God wants the very best for you. But you are letting your fears hold you back. Face your fear in the name of Jesus Christ. Put your trust in Him and you will experience true life, life that can be stolen by the spirit of fear. Fear is an indication that you don't trust God to see you through the problems you're in. You have the power of God in your life. I mean the resurrection power. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Psalm 27:1. He purchased me, He released me, He guides me, He protects me, He saves me. If you confess these words regularly and believe them, what's there to fear? He has given us love. 1 John 4:8. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. In other words, you don't have to fear anything because God loves you. Remember, fear and trust cannot reside in the same heart at the same time. You won't find fear in a trust-filled heart, and you won't find trust in a fearful heart. He has given us a sound mind. God has given us a sound mind so that when Satan comes trying to deceive or confuse us with what is true and what is false, we would easily discern them. We need to stop letting Satan intimidate us with the spirit of fear. As you study the Bible and meditate on what God says about you, you will recognize the fears in your life that are holding you back and overcome them by seeing yourself in Christ. Then you will realize you have whatever you need to do what you are created to do. Prayer. In the name of Jesus, I refuse to fear because God has not given me the spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. I bind the spirit of fear in my life in the name of Jesus. Amen.
As a child of God, you are protected. The protection God gives may not be obvious to you, but know you are protected. God's protection may not be visible to the naked eye, but you need to know that you are protected. All throughout the Bible, God gives His assurance of our protection, so there's no need for a child of God to fear. As 2 Timothy 1 verse 7 says, "For God has not given us the spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, love, and of self-discipline." Fear is not of God. Fear is not something that children of the Most High should have. The enemy uses fear to attack us, to try to break us down. But as children of God, we need to have 2 Timothy chapter 1 imprinted in our hearts and in our minds. You must tell yourself that fear does not come from God. That fear is not your portion. It is not of God, but love and sound mind are your portion. So when the enemy comes knocking on your door, ready to put fear in your heart, remember, God has not given you the spirit of fear, and that God is on your side. You have a God that protects you. How do I know this? It's simple, because the Bible tells me so. Over and over again, we see God's assurance of His protection in the Bible. He is our protector, our defender. Psalms 18 verse 2, "The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my savior. My God is my rock in whom I find protection." Protection. Do you know what that means? It means God is strong and solid like a rock. He is unchanging. God won't change His mind about protecting you. You are one of His. He is your fortress. There is no enemy that can breach His walls. No enemy can overrun God. He is your fortress that will be there in your time of need. You can rely on God.
One thing that gives me endless joy, and each time I remember, it is my heritage and strength in Christ. In a world filled with uncertainty, what keeps me going daily and keeps me assured of the future and journey ahead is the love and protection of Christ over me. When we go through really hard times of winter days, when the weather of our lives seems so harsh and unfavorable, God is definitely with us. He is waiting and beckoning to us on the other side. As long as we trust in the Lord and our God, no weapon fashioned against us, no matter how sophisticated they are, shall prosper. When we are walking through fire, and it seems as if the heat will consume us, let us remember the three Hebrew men and how God delivered them from the fiercest furnace there was at that time. He is a great God. Not only did He deliver them in that fire, He was seen in that fire with them. Our God is great. He doesn't just deliver you out of situations, but He enters into those situations with you. This is why some of our greatest personal illuminations about God come during our darkest moments in life. God will not let you down. When men conspire against us to do everything just to bring us down and see our downfall, let us remember Daniel and how God shut the mouth of the hungry. When the devil is constantly bringing temptations our way just to make us derail from the path of righteousness, let us study the scriptures and read about Job's ordeals and how God gave him the last say and double for all his losses.
when everyone is against us and you have enemies on every side, remember what God did for Jehoshaphat. God came through for him and gave them victory on a silver platter. We can go on and on with these examples and how God came through for each one of these people in the end. Whatever ugly experience it is we are going through right now, it is transient. It is just for a while. God will not sit by and watch with folded arms while evil swallows and triumphs over our lives. He is not a God that abandons or forsakes. Never! The scriptures also assured us that we would never be overcome by evil or darkness, because nothing that is born of God is subdued by the world or subservient to the power of darkness. 1 John 5:4. For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world. Even if it is just us against the whole world, we will still come out triumphant. With Christ on our side, victory is certain. As a believer, our report in reality does not stem from our situation, but from what God has ordained and has said concerning us. There will be attacks, but victory is assured. Imagine a scenario where you are told to sit back, relax, and watch while someone else shoulders all your responsibilities and never wants anything in return. And before you even know that there is a lack or void, they have already stepped into the situation to fix it. That's what we are doing when we let Christ fight all our battles on our behalf. Exodus 14:14, the Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. God will fight for you. On our own, we can't win the endless battles of our life. Our wisdom, eloquence, and intelligence mean absolutely nothing against the devil. They are unseen battles with unseen forces, hence the need to engage the supernatural. The Bible in 2 Corinthians 10:4 confirmed that carnal weapons can't fight spiritual warfare. 2 Corinthians 10:4, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. This is why we have to hand over the fight to God to give us victory. God's word doesn't promise us that from when we give our lives to Christ till when we get to heaven, it is all enjoyment galore and freedom from challenges. That is a delusion. As a matter of fact, the moment we give our lives to Christ is when the kingdom of darkness will be on the prowl, devising every means to make us fall and falter. Jesus didn't promise his disciples a life devoid of tribulations and trials, but he indeed promised them victory over every challenge. John 16:33. These things I have spoken to you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. There isn't definitely any greater assurance than this. No weapon fashioned against us shall prosper, declares the word of the Lord in the opening verse of Isaiah 54:17. Note the use of no weapon. It means it doesn't matter where it was made or what it was made from, they will definitely not prosper. Inasmuch as they are against us, nothing can be more absolute or audacious. Isaiah 54:17, no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper, and every tongue that shall rise against thee in judgment shall thou condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. Isaiah the prophet knew something we don't appreciate enough. This is God's word. This is God himself telling you, no weapon will accomplish that in which it has been sent to accomplish. The devil has different weapons. We see in the book of Job that disease is a weapon of his. But child of God, you don't have to fear. God has promised you it will not prosper. it will not win. The weapon that is formed against you could be against your marriage. The weapon against you may be emotional pain. But you can live in divine assurance to know that no weapon will prosper. Your health will recover because the Bible says by His stripes we were healed. Your marriage will recover because the Bible says God will restore to you the years that the swarming locusts have eaten. Your business will recover because the Bible says God will restore to you the years that the swarming locusts have eaten. Nothing is more reassuring than knowing that God is with us and always on our side. No matter what it is we are facing or going through, there is a shining light at the end of the Lord. It won't swallow us, no matter how scary or gigantic it is. Victory is assured for those who will trust in the Lord and make Him their refuge in the days of adversity. The flesh might be nudging us to do that which is against the will of the Lord or cut corners. Even when trusting God doesn't seem to make sense, we shouldn't throw in the towel or chicken out. God is in our boat. Hang in there. We all have to hold on to this promise that God gave Isaiah. Because at one point or another, weapons will be formed against you. Whether it be to do with your physical health, whether it be financially or maritally or emotionally, we all need to stand our ground and know that God has promised us whatever is going on, whatever has been thrown against us will not prosper. You can either live in victory or choose to live in defeat. Live in victory today and know that you will get through this.
And then here you are, in whatever struggle or trial you are going through. Yet God is with you. And if the truth be told, some of you listening to me are going through the water like Peter, and going through the furnace like the Hebrew boys. And I just want to encourage you today. God is walking with every step of the way, through the good times and the bad times, through the sunshine and the rain, through the trials and storms, through the hardship and battles, through uncertain times. Whatever fires or waters you may face, you are not alone.
Wrestling with your angel. Genesis 32, verse 26 to 29. And he said, "Let me go, for the day breaketh." And he said, "I will not let thee go, except thou bless me." And he said unto him, "What is thy name?" And he said, "Jacob." And he said, "Thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince hast thou power with God and with men, and hast prevailed." And Jacob asked him, and said, "Tell me, I pray thee, thy name." And he said, "Wherefore is it that thou dost ask after my name?" And he blessed him there. Believers are spiritual warriors we fight to win. There is no hero without a battle. The truth is, there is no conquest without a contest. There is no victory without a fight. There is no testimony without a test, and no miracle without impossible circumstances. There is a spiritual law of cause and effect.
If you want to change a situation, then you have to cause it to happen. You see, we will never get anything done by folding our arms and waiting hopelessly. Genesis 28, verse 10 to 22 gives an account of how Jacob left Beersheba and was on his way to Haran. When he got to Bethel, it was already late, and he had to sleep. While he slept, he saw the vision of angels ascending and descending a ladder whose top reached to heaven. When Jacob woke, he said that God was in that place, and he never knew it. It is regrettable for one to miss an opportunity he got to change his destiny. For many believers, this has been the case. They had folded their arms, waiting for things to turn around for their good, when they actually had several opportunities to have prayed and gained their victories. There are some opportunities that do not come often. At such, when they do come, we need to take full advantage of them. For Jacob, it took several years before he regained the chance he had lost. After spending several years with his uncle Laban, he was returning home to make peace with his brother when he had another encounter with an angel by night. This time around, Jacob would not let go because he did not know if he will ever have another opportunity. Jacob had a burning desire within him. Jacob took hold of the angel and wrestled with him. Why did Jacob have to wrestle with the angel? He wrestled with the angel because he knew that he could transform his destiny. Until we realize that God is all we need, we may never take advantage of persistent prayers to solve our problems. Jacob was greatly determined that night. He wrestled with the angel until the breaking of the day. Night prayers are very strategic. I think there is something quite special about it. Several destinies are destroyed by night, while some destinies are also transformed by night. If only men had learned to take the night watch seriously, the enemy would have sown tares among their wheat. Matthew 13, verse 25. Jacob employed all his strength to wrestle with the angel, and he requested that the angel should bless him. Jacob needed blessings because his life had been full of toiling and hardship. For Jacob, his wrestling with the angel had cost him something: the dislocation of his thigh. However, he had a testimony that he wrestled with both man and God and prevailed. As a result of his prevalence over the angel, a nation was birthed: Israel. Genesis 32, verse 28. So, we see from Jacob's story that a man could wrestle with God and prevail. But this is only made possible in the place of prayers. Many of us give up when praying because we feel that we are not getting the desired results. Sometimes we need to be tenacious until we get that which belongs to us. Jacob had enough excuse to give up that night, seeing that the angel had knocked his thigh out of joint. But he would rather die wrestling with the angel than living outside of God's destined purpose for his life. What many believers don't know is that their persistence in this place of prayers will go a long way to affect the upcoming generation positively. You see, The destiny of the nation of Israel was in Jacob, the night he wrestled. Some of us may not know what lurks up in the inside of us until we pray persistently to birth it out. The blessing of your children could be locked up inside of you and won't release until you wrestle with your angel in prayer. Jacob was desperate to be blessed. Are you desperate to be blessed? Jacob was desperate for a breakthrough. Are you desperate for a breakthrough? Jacob wrestled with his angel. Are you going to wrestle with your angel? Prayer has got to cost something. It is not free. Your breakthrough is not a handout. You won't get it out of pity. You have got to work for it. It cost Jacob his sleep, for he wrestled with the angel all night until the angel had to say, "Let me go, for it is daybreak." Sleep was a luxury Jacob could not afford. It will cost you your time. Prayer will cost you. It cost Jacob his hip and walked the rest of his life with a limp, but by God was he blessed. Do you not think Jacob felt like quitting? Of course he did. But he didn't, because when you feel like quitting, that is when your breakthrough starts. You have to reach such a point of desperation that you are willing to get your breakthrough, no matter the cost, no matter the pain, no matter how many sleepless nights, no matter how many times you get knocked down, you have got to get up. Prayer is not easy. You have got to fight to pray. You have got to fight for your breakthrough. No excuses, put in the work and you will get out what you need. Now let me ask you, are you willing to pay the cost? Are you as desperate as Jacob to be blessed? Prayer is the way to release your blessing, but it comes at a cost. So pray, pray, pray until you get your answer. Until you get your blessing, until you get your breakthrough. This is not a laughing matter. This is serious. This is a fight. This is warfare. Pray like never before. Pray like Jacob did. Your prayers will not only affect you, it will also affect people around you too. Never give up until you see the substance of what you are praying for. Unfortunately, many people gave up praying for their breakthrough if they don't see instant results. If Jacob had left the angel an hour before he blessed him, he would have only wasted his time wrestling. Many of us have been praying. You must pray until something happens. Howbeit, our warfare is not physical but spiritual. We do not have to wrestle with any physical enemy. Even those who parade themselves as our physical enemies are only sponsored by our spiritual enemy. Our wrestling is spiritual. When we win spiritually, then we can reign physically. Ephesians 6 verse 12 says, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." However, we do not only wrestle with wicked spirits. There are times that we need to wrestle with God also. Wrestling with God does not imply that we are in combat with Him, but that we stand firm in prayers until we get the fullest of our blessings. The testimony you are expecting is not without a price. Effectual prayer is that price you must pay. You too can prevail over whatever is holding the testimonies you have long awaited. if you tarry enough in the place of prayers.
Whatever you do, don't let your angel go until you are blessed. Jacob was at the point of desperation. It was make or break for Jacob. You see, Jacob had a vision of angels ascending and descending, and he knew he had missed his opportunity that time. But years later, when he had another opportunity, he was not willing to let go without any result. Now I'm encouraging you in your prayer time, you must have the same tenacity and the same determination to say to your angel, just like Jacob did, I will not let you go until you bless me. Is your situation desperate enough for such a prayer? If everything in your life is rosy and lovely, you won't be willing to go to the same length as Jacob. But if you are desperate, pray and keep going. Pray and don't let your angel go. Pray and don't let your blessing go. I will not let you go until you bless me.